I'm really happy to be rejoined by Michael Hill and his partner Danny Brewster so they can update us on what's happening in the region. Michael, it's great to have you back on the show.
Hi, Adam. Thanks for having me, man.
Absolutely. So we're also joined by Danny Brewster. Danny Brewster is your business partner, right, for your ventures in Cyprus?
He's basically the mastermind behind this project. That's how I like to call it. I'm more of helping him out in marketing and advertising department here in Cyprus.
It's been a few months. Can you catch us up? What's happened during that time? What have you been able to accomplish? You know, it seems like you've definitely made some progress.
A lot has happened. Since then, what has followed are many layoffs. Economic downturn has dampened the mood. The economy of Cyprus seems to be at a standstill right now, in a sense that people don't trust banks. Businessmen have to struggle with capital controls. In general, it seems like Cyprus is headed for a very serious recession this year. Generally speaking, the central banking system has failed people here in Cyprus. That's how they see it. Like you said, we last spoke back in April. Back then, the mood was much different. As we know, Bitcoin spiked in price and during the Eurogroup decision in March 15th. Most people have forgotten what's been happening here in Cyprus. Even though Cyprus is out of the headlines as of late, people here are dealing with a new reality of a collapsed banking system. That's where we come in.
When we spoke last, you were getting ready to head to Cyprus and you were in Greece at the time. You know, what was the initial experience like trying to introduce these concepts to people? Because again, like you said, the banking system and the central banking system has failed. And yet, yeah. I don't think that there's any talk about anything like leaving the euro and taking back control of the currency locally, is there?
Well, there were certain politicians that tried to popularize the idea of getting out of the euro and maybe reissuing the pound, but quickly those discussions just ceased. You know, they just stopped. Nobody considers it a viable option for Cyprus. And certainly there is no politician gunning for that option right now. So the mood in Cyprus right now that we really have no choice. We have to stay in the euro. We have to follow the decisions from the Eurogroup and the Troika. To a lot of people, when we come out and say, look, there's another alternative. You can start using Bitcoin. People need to be educated for sure about Bitcoin. I mean, we need more Greek language content, more meetings on the ground here in Cyprus, more person-to-person talks with merchants, business people, consumers. That's how we're getting things done. It's a relatively slow process, certainly a lot slower than maybe a lot of people would like, but we're making sure in steady steps to ensure that this business will be a success in this market.
When we first spoke, you had the idea about focusing on education and trying to bring awareness, but the project that you guys have grown into involves a couple of different businesses. First one is, I think the one that everything is built off of is called Neo. Can you tell us a little bit about that, Danny?
Yeah, sure. Neo is going to provide brick and mortar branches around the island so people can obtain Bitcoin in the most easy way, in the way that they are used to dealing with a financial institution. And we're going to make it really accessible. So we'll give them a wallet that we look after the security for. And also we remove all the complexities from Bitcoin in its raw format that myself, Michael, and pretty much all of your listeners are used to dealing with. So it's common for them. But the average man or woman in the street are somewhat put off by the complexities of Bitcoin. As soon as you start talking to them, you can see them switch off within 30 seconds of you mentioning the word cryptography. We're looking to remove all of that, take care of it all, and let them use Bitcoin in a way that suits their needs best.
So what does that look like? I guess I have two questions here. First off, when we're talking about brick and mortar locations, are these locations where you're partnering with an existing bank to provide Bitcoin services, or is this a business entirely devoted to this Neo concept of Bitcoin banking?
Yes, we're opening our own Neo branches around the island.
We're starting from scratch, basically. Everything's from scratch, you know, yeah. Freshly baked like Mama used to do.
We need to ensure that we can build our own trust and develop that trust over a period of time with our customers and the Cypriot people. To go and partner with an existing bank and offer these, it would go against the grain of everything because the traditional banks don't have that trust anymore. There's a piece been released in the newspaper here today that shows, following a recent survey, how many people actually trust the banks here. And it is 4 in 5 do not trust any of the traditional banks.
Yeah.
I'm sure that there are lots of people around the world who would like to do what it is that you're doing there, where you're offering, you know, very accessible banking services, or you're hoping to offer very accessible banking services. But there are a variety of reasons, many of them regulatory, that sort of seem like they prevent that. Is the situation different in Cyprus? Or like you said, you know, since the banking system has collapsed, there are limits to the control.
No, there is no limits to their control. First of all, to make us regulated, they need to recognize Bitcoin as money. That is something that we're lobbying through our lawyers and our accounting partners, and also some other existing businesses. We're getting involved with this process now to create a clear and concise legal framework for Bitcoin businesses to operate within. So Cyprus can then attract outside investment, which is something that Cyprus really wants for itself. Through having that clear and concise legal framework, it will become a hotbed and literally create a whole new Bitcoin industry in Cyprus, because there's so many people looking to find a friendly jurisdiction where they know where they stand. That's what we're lobbying for here. And because Cyprus is so small, we can get direct to the decision makers, and we already have. So we've always got the clear channels of communication with these people to ensure this can happen.
Cyprus has a long history of, it's a service-oriented economy. So we do have the workforce and the infrastructure even to make something like this work. Also, it has a long tradition of commerce. Cyprus is not so much a producer or farming economy or a primary sector economy. It's very much geared toward the tertiary sector, services, finance, and business. This, along with the economic situation, with the collapse of the banks and the economic downturn, it really makes Cyprus an ideal place to open this business.
Going on from that, somebody said to me that hadn't heard of Bitcoins prior to meeting me about 3 months ago. He's now one of the biggest Bitcoin followers out there. He fills my email inbox every day with every single Bitcoin news story with his own comments. He said to me, for revolution to occur, you need a big bang event. And the bail-ins was that big bang event, which has provided the platform for this to succeed here in Cyprus, to hand the power back to the people that was left powerless by those that have taken their trust and abused it.
So you said that you're going to hide a lot of the complexity from users. Can you give us a little bit of detail about what parts specifically you've identified?
The first one is your Bitcoin address, 34 character key. To look at it, compared to an 8-digit account number that you'd get with a traditional bank, absolutely everybody that I've spoken to prefers the 8-digit account number. So we're going to be changing behaviors, but not changing them too fast, because if you try and enforce too much change too quickly, people just reject it. We're going to let them interact with us how they do their normal traditional bank, so we can make that change slowly over a period of time.
Let me just take a guess here. What you're going to do is you're going to give them an account number that'll be with Neo, and then that'll be connected to one or multiple Bitcoin addresses.
Yes, in the back end, we're going to be using multiple signature addresses. So if the account holder was to suddenly pass away or anything, the heirs to that money can obtain the balance from that wallet. And also, should we fail as a business through another third legal party, they can provide the two private keys to gain access to that wallet. So even if we're not here as a business anymore, people can still get their money out.
Both parties turn their keys at the same time, and there are three keys out there that work.
Yes.
That sounds like an interesting way to remove a lot of the complexity without removing any of the limitations. And, you know, the multi-sig key thing is a really interesting way to go about that. It's like people are partnering with you to secure their funds, because on their own, they lack the ability to do that. And on your own, you don't have the ability to do that and still make it available to them in the way that they need it to be available. So I think that's an interesting solution for that.
Yes. Plus, it also removes the possibility of us failing and the customer's money disappearing at the same time. And also, it protects their sons, daughters, grandchildren's inheritance, so they can always access those coins. The contract that we have with third party, we will make it publicly known who that third party is once the final decision has been made. So that contract between ourselves will ensure that we cannot just take a customer's money. All they can do is, at the request of the customer or in the presence of a death certificate, provide access to that wallet.
This interlocks with your other system, which is called B. And B seems to me to be kind of like a transaction network. Is that right?
Yes, it's our version of Visa or MasterCard. The name was taken because the president at the time of the bail-ins was talking about a plan B that he never really had. So we've called the payment network B, as in plan B. And also, we can tie the Bitcoin logo into the B logo as well.
And also because everyone loves bees, I guess.
So with B, it will allow our customer to access their funds through a network of merchants. We can provide almost instant settlements and much, much lower transaction fees in comparison to the monopoly holder here in Cyprus that provides payment gateways. Because of that monopoly holder, e-commerce hasn't taken off in Cyprus as it has in pretty much every other country in the world.
I would also add that the payment network also answers the very frequent question of, okay, what can I do with Bitcoins? In the Bitcoin meetings, people are saying, okay, say that I buy a Bitcoin. I mean, who's going to accept it? How do I use it? This would be an obvious answer. We're planning on initially launching with a network of 1,000 merchants in Cyprus that will accept the B payment network. Once we have that in place, it'll be a lot easier to convince people to deposit their money with NEO and to use the payment network card.
Have you been talking to merchants about that yet?
Yes. I really wish that I could get a big blockbuster news, but we're just waiting to sign the contracts on the second one, but I can guarantee it will make a few headlines within Bitcoin.
Yes, and also I can say that a lot of people here in the Nicosia, a lot of merchants, like small shop owners or just convenience store owners, things like that, they're very interested in this, especially with the low transaction fees and the instant pay settlements. I mean, those two are just so obvious advantages to them. So they're practically sold right now, I would say.
So from the user's perspective, what does a B transaction look like? Is it like a debit card transaction?
To use the B network, we're going to be using EMV chip and PIN systems, but we're also adding a second layer of authentication because Bitcoin being irreversible and instantaneous, we need to ensure that a card and PIN cannot just become compromised as it is with a traditional bank. So what we've added in is fingerprint technology so it doesn't slow down transaction time. There is other ways to do it, but people in Cyprus, there isn't a great market penetration of smartphone users as there are in other parts of the world. So the easiest way for us to do it is through fingerprint technology and the chip and PIN system. So to compromise the card, they need to cut the person's finger off and get their PIN number and the card to be able to use it in the store. Online, we're going to be introducing for both our online account management services and for online card purchases, we're going to use a chip and PIN smart card reader, which is very common in the UK, and it has reduced the losses to online banking fraud drastically since the introduction of these. It provides, once the customers put the card into the reader, entered the PIN number, provided the response codes on the screen, which will then provide the customer with a number that they must respond into the system with to add another layer of authentication.
So this is two-factor authentication where you have a little point-of-sale card reader device plugged into your computer.
It's not much bigger than a credit card itself. Almost all the banks in the United Kingdom use them. And they have had really high success rates of reducing compromised accounts online.
It's much safer.
Yeah.
So what's the catch? Not specifically with the card reader, but with your project in general, what are the risks and dangers you're still trying to overcome?
The biggest one is the price volatility with Bitcoin. That was a barrier of entry to our customers. So we are going to be offering pegged accounts. And most of the concerns that have been brought up from within the community is that a lack of platforms to trade options and futures. So we've gone out and spoken with the operators of the existing platforms that have vast amounts of liquidity on their platforms, and the response has been great. Some of them are going to be included in our lobbying process. One this morning was already planning all types of different funds that they could offer in Bitcoin before I'd even left the room. So the response there has been great. We know that we need to get these platforms to be able to reduce the risk on ourselves, and that'll be an added benefit for Bitcoin because throughout the forums and threads on Reddit and places like that, people constantly complain that they have a lack of options in trading platforms because it's very much restricted to the common 3-4 exchanges. So we've gone out there to speak with the operators of these platforms, which can increase the amount of liquidity and increase the volume in Bitcoin itself with their own existing customer base. But it also gives people from within Bitcoin already a chance to acquire the services that they've been looking for quite a while.
These aren't conventional Bitcoin exchanges. They're more like legacy platforms that deal with traditional Forex?
Yes, traditional financial market sector, yes.
And you're partnering with them to integrate Bitcoin into their offerings?
We're not essentially partnering with them. We're selling Bitcoin to them to get them to introduce it into their offerings. We will have trading relationships with some of the platforms because we'll need to use them.
I see. So rather than trying to bootstrap locally using only the liquidity available in Cyprus, you've gone to the international market and are using their liquidity to make sure all your local needs are met while growing the Cyprus market.
Yes.
Okay, so again, what's the catch?
From the outset, I set out when I was developing this idea, even before the banking fiasco that happened in March and April here, what are the problems for Bitcoin to catch on a mass scale? Complexity, can I spend my money? The volatility. So through addressing each one of those problems, it brought up new problems, which have been well documented in the thread, and I've been unable that I couldn't really talk about it too much. But now things have progressed even further. I've brought meetings forward to ensure that I could provide more information than was previously envisioned. So we've gone out and addressed, we've made the connections with the regulators, the lawyers, the accountancy firms, and the people that are working in finance here already. So we've got all the contacts, and most of them are great on the idea. A lot of these people have lost out in the banks already, so they want to see an alternative. The biggest part that we keep getting told by these people is you've got to market it right, which is why we've partnered with Telia and Pavla. And some of the activities that we've got that Michael will be able to tell you about even in more detail. Our first for Bitcoin again, we're advertising on the TV with airlines as well, airports.
We're planning a full media campaign for when we launch, full PR campaign as well, organizing road shows and talking to merchants and setting up the network and then advertising to the general public about NEO. We've been working with Telia and Pavla on this, and they're ready to go. We're just waiting for the right moment to pull the trigger on that. Yeah, like you said, you're looking for the catch here. The fact that you're finding it hard to find a catch, it just shows how much sense this business model makes in the conditions that we're living in right now here in Cyprus. It just seems to be like the perfect storm of events have come together, you know, to create this business. And we're really confident that it'll work.
There is always risk involved. I don't want people to think that we're ignoring risks. If Bitcoin was to catastrophically implode, there is risk involved, but we've taken steps to ensure that we have a contingency plan for each and every possible case scenario. We are operating on the full reserve basis, and there's a spreadsheet going to be released which demonstrates just exactly how we can trade, and people themselves, including yourself, Adam, can put their figures in. The spreadsheet is preloaded with all the figures from the height of the April crash down to the lowest point when it crashed 75% across 2 days. We've already included those figures. So if anybody wants to add their own figures, their own amount of deposits, spread them out differently between time-based accounts and instant access accounts, they'll be able to do that and see how exactly our business model operates to ensure that the customer has always got the correct amount of Bitcoins in their wallet.
So the full reserve basis is an interesting thing. We've seen people talk about or attempt Bitcoin banks before, but you seem fairly far along in the process. What's the next step? What's required to make this actually happen?
The IPVO will start on Friday at 1 p.m. EST.
Okay, what's an IPVO?
It's initial public virtual offering. Many people within Bitcoin refer to them as an IPO, which is very much a Wall Street term. But what we're offering is essentially crowdfunding with a profit share. So we wanted to differentiate ourselves from the traditional stock markets. It's not traded on Wall Street. It's traded on Bitfunder, and it's accessible through BTC, TC and Havelock as well. We're getting the collective from within the Bitcoin community to raise the initial capital required to take all of these steps. Things have been pretty positive so far, but I don't count my chicken until it's done.
So if you're not using the fractional reserve model, how are you planning to generate this profit?
What we're going to be doing is removing the negative risk of the volatility. So when the price drops, we add more Bitcoins to our customers' wallets from our own reserves. When the price increases, the exchange rate increases of Bitcoin, that's where we make our profits from those accounts. Yeah. We do have some time-based deposits accounts between 6 and 60 months where people can essentially put their money into their wallet for 6 months, 12 months, 24. They'll receive a percentage of every month's growth, and then we as NEO will benefit from the rest, but we also provide the protection against the falls in the price. So they're offered the potential to earn more as Bitcoin grows itself. That also ensures the coins aren't going to be withdrawn for 6 or 12 or 24 months. We're going to be offering insurance products through a carrier, so we can brand the products, and that's very much still in the works. We're not just operating on the basis that the Bitcoin price is going to go up. We are looking to bring in other additional streams of income, such as international money remittance, transaction fees on B and the POS rental charge. We've tried to be as fair as we possibly can for the merchants. The first 1,000 merchants, we're removing all barriers to the adoption, so they're getting free transactions and a free POS terminal. So they have the added incentive to talking to their customers to getting them to pay with B, because they don't have to pay 3, 4, 5, up to 10%, and they get the money almost instantly. So
that sounds like a really interesting approach. You're letting people locally use Bitcoin without any of the price fluctuations, and you're funding by essentially letting investors speculate on your local customers' behalf. So your investors are taking on the price volatility risk for better or for worse, and the people who just want a functional transaction network can use it that way.
When the balance in their wallet decreases because each one of those Bitcoins is worth more, the balance goes into our reserves.
That would be for accounts pegged in euro. If someone has a deposit in Bitcoin, obviously the price fluctuation won't affect the amount of Bitcoin in there.
Right, but similarly, they're not protected from the price decreasing and the volume in their account would decrease along with it.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
We expect the majority of our initial customers to take on the pegged accounts.
It makes sense. It makes it stable so you can conduct commerce.
Yes. We're giving the people the opportunity to use the part of the Bitcoin protocol which benefits them the most. And right now here, the public feel is the majority of them just want to protect their money. And following research that we'd done previously, the majority would rather put some money away and potentially get a return, but know that that money just cannot be taken by the bank or by the government to pay for somebody else's mistakes, than get a guaranteed 2% over a 12-month period and not know if they're getting that money back at the end of it.
So if somebody wants to learn more or get involved in your project, what are the best ways to do that?
The prospectus is available at lmb-holdings.com. You can find us in the securities thread of bitcointalk.org. More than approachable myself, my username pretty much everywhere is Crypto Cyprus. So people can get in touch with me. Those that have asked me questions already have always had a response, and I'll continue that as much as my time allows. I am doing 20-hour days pretty much every day, but I am very much wanting to be open and transparent with everybody and answer all questions, concerns with regards to the business. So
as far as the general public is concerned, there have been criticisms about the legality or the regulation surrounding Bitcoin, what any future regulation would be imposed on Bitcoin. Of course, we can't answer that. We don't know. But Danny has said from the beginning that we are going to be fully compliant with any ECB rules and regulations that may be introduced in the future.
But we're also taking the proactive approach to saying to them, right, we would much rather take the front foot and have a say in any framework that is created or provided or guidelines that are provided for Bitcoin businesses. It's better to have somebody from the inside that knows what Bitcoin is and what it is capable of, to have a say directly with the regulators. So that is something that we're addressing from the start as well. That was one of the concerns from the public when we spoke to them. So that's why we're making these lobbying efforts as well.
Well, guys, I'm really excited about your project. Looks like you've got a lot of traction with the idea, and it's a good one. Danny and Michael, thanks for joining me on Let's Talk Bitcoin. We'll catch up with you again soon and look forward to your continued progress.
Okay, thanks, Adam. Hope to see you in Cyprus sometime.
Yeah, sometime soon.
Brilliant.
Hi, Stephanie here. Would you like to turn your book into an enthralling audiobook? Need a persuasive commercial to promote your company? How about a narrator for your explainer video? Here's where I can help. I'm a freelance voiceover artist, and since 2009, I've lent my voice to dozens of audio projects. To hear some examples of my work, check out my website, smvoice.info. If you like what you hear, I'd love to be the voice of your next project. Get in touch at smvoice.info.